just to set the stage, I want to think about some urban myths that are out there. There's a commonly heard statement that one should drink at least 8 ounces, 8 ounces each, of water each day to be healthy. So I want to examine this a little bit. Is there data that supports that statement? If so, how robust are those claims? Are there health benefits of drinking that much water? Are there possible ill effects of such behavior? And for healthy individuals, what should be the recommended fluid intake? What's the data that supports any of that? So this 8x8 has really become part of our culture. In fact, looking out in the audience, I see probably 20 or 30 different water bottles right in front of me. If you look at the UCLA student handbook, it counsels students to, quote, carry a water bottle with you and drink often while sitting in class. These below are some of our medical students who have all water bottles in class, even though they're sitting there doing almost absolutely nothing. They're not doing nothing, but they're doing close to nothing. Then I'm going to pick on Jane Brody, New York Times. She had an article in July 2000, For Lifelong Gains, Just Add Water. It says, don't rely on thirst to tell you when to drink. This is New York Times. By the time thirst hits, you're already mildly dehydrated. Even mild dehydration can impair physical and mental performance. 8 8-ounce glasses should be the minimum for the average person. IDEA, and I've looked all over to find out what IDEA is, and I can't find out what that group is, actually, suggests calculating basic fluid needs by dividing your weight in half to get the number of ounces to consume each day. She goes on to say it's not wise to rely solely on thirst to guide your water intake, nor should quenching your thirst be a measure of whether you've drunk enough. To calculate how much water you need each day, she gives you another formula here. I like this one. Multiply your weight in pounds by 0.08. The result is your requirement in 8-ounce cups. So for a 200-pound adult, not uncommon in the US, that requires 16 cups a day. But if you just give that a break and say half of our water intake probably comes from food intake, again, you get about the 8 cups per day there. Show you a little bit how this has kind of gotten into advertising. And I don't forget the audio here. Just gonna put
when you're not hydrated, your brain's not at 100%.
Geraldine?
When you can't think straight.
Hydrate, deep river rock.
All right, so that's what happens if you don't hydrate. All right, so what are the origins of this statement? Where in the world did this come from? So it's really unclear. So there's no scientific evidence that I think you can find that really finds this statement. Now, it's mentioned in an early book by this guy, Frederick Stare, who in 1974 was thought to be a nutritionist, who said, water intake is usually well regulated by various physiological mechanisms. I think you've heard that this morning. If you wait for these mechanisms to determine our water intake, we will already be dehydrated. But he didn't really have any experiments to back that statement. And in fact, if you even go back further, in 1945, the Food and Nutrition Board of the National Research Council published this statement, again without much data. Suitable allowance of water for adults is 2.5 liters daily in most instances. An ordinary standard for diverse persons is 1 milliliter for every calorie of food. Most of this quantity is in prepared foods. I think probably that last sentence had been ignored and maybe dropped over time. And really the first part of that may be in part the early genesis of this 8x8. So if you actually look at customary daily fluid intake and look at how it's changed over time, I think you see kind of some interesting occurrences and just how powerful this cultural mythology, I think, has become. So before that 8x8, if you look back in the 1970s, and look at the beverages in the total without caffeine, caffeinated beverages without alcohol, if you remove those, it's about a liter a day. If you look after 8x8 at studies looking at average daily beverage content in the mid-1990s, late 1990s, it had gone up to about 1,500 cc's per day. So there had been about a 25% increase in water consumption. There'd been roughly a doubling of soft drink and alcohol intake, a 2.5-fold increase in juice intake, and the current intake actually came up to about 8.8. Now, in 2010, just to perpetuate this, the European Food Safety Agency recommended a daily total water intake of 2.5 liters for men, 2 liters for women. They said that 20% of this probably comes from your total intake of food, but also recommends, interestingly enough, and I don't know how people would do this during the day, that your urine osmolality should be maintained around 500. And that's equivalent to achieving a urine volume of about 1.6 liters for women and about 2 liters for men on an average Western diet. Now, is their recommendation for safe water intake. So I think the question is, do average healthy individuals living in a temperate climate need to drink extra fluid, even when you're not thirsty, to somehow maintain health? Now, there's some caveats that probably extra water intake is warranted. I just gave you a couple down there. Joe gave you an example of patients with diabetes insipidus or patients who lose salt in the kidneys. Those are special circumstances. Those are the exceptions. But the question is, do we need to drink water above our thirst mechanism? Is there data that supports that? So in the lay literature, let's go back to Jane Brody, who I'm going to pick on again in New York Times. What are the benefits of a high water intake? So she states, water lubricates every joint in your body and keeps tissue from sticking together. You don't want your tissue to stick together. Anybody have a problem with that today? With dehydration, your body and brain become sluggish. Your blood thickens and your heart is forced to work overly hard. That sounds pretty bad. Water is also the body's air conditioning system. Skin cells, too, don't forget them. They need to water to look healthy. Every system in your body, from brain to bowel, depends upon water. As IDEA, this International Health and Fitness Organization, has pointed out, I think they're like actually more like chaos in the Get Smart group. Water regulates body temperature, transports nutrients and oxygen, carries away waste, helps detoxify the kidneys and liver, dissolves vitamins and minerals, and cushions the body from injury. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? So what were the other claimed benefits of water intake? So if you look at some older studies, at least in the scientific literature, there actually was a little bit of a data source that said water intake was important. And so probably some of the best data comes from bladder cancer incidence, looking at people and their fluid intake. And bladder cancer incidence, I'm going to go on and show you some more recent data, is reduced by higher fluid intakes. And the reduced risk was about 7% for every 8-ounce increase in intake. Mostly that benefit was seen in males. There was also some old studies that looked at colon cancer and colon polyps and showed that there was an inverse correlation between total fluid intake and that risk for colon cancer. And then finally, there was a little bit of data in women and men that if you drank more than 5 glasses of water a day, that somehow you had a reduced incidence of coronary disease. There are a lot of confounders there about other behaviors that probably went with that water drinking behavior that I think makes that conclusion somewhat suspect. So what about other complaint benefits? Does it promote satiety and weight loss? No study has made it ever clear that whether drinking a large volume of water over a course of a day actually decreases the amount of ingested calories. And there's also various claims in the literature that increased water intake improves things like fatigue, arthritis, constipation, mental awareness, angina. Most of this is really in the lay literature without a lot of scientific studies that show this. There's really no evidence that I could find in researching this talk that supports any of those claims. So what are the recent data and what are the areas of controversy? I want to cover 4 things here. I want to talk about kidney stones, urinary tract infections, progression of kidney disease, and then bladder cancer. Now first, what about prevention of kidney stones, nephrolithiasis? And so there's 2 real big promoters of kidney stones. The first is a Western diet with increasing waste products that promote stones, calcium phosphates, an acidic urine. Then finally, insufficient fluid intake. And that leads the combination to those increased weight products, that low urine volume, to the supersaturation of the urine with calcium salts that form stones. And in fact, if you look at any predictive equation for the risk of kidney stones, urine volume is certainly a determinant of our risk for kidney stones. If you look epidemiologically across the United States, the dark red is the higher incidence of kidney stones. It tends to be concentrated in the southeastern United States in warmer climates, but also in climates and areas that are associated with different dietary patterns as well. So kidney stone incidence, again, is again high in there. It's called the stone belt because of the area. But what about fluid intake? Well, an earlier study suggested, at least in marathon runners, if you look at the athletes under 45 years old, they were 5 times more likely to develop kidney stones as those between age 45 and 64, and they were 3 times more likely compared to their matched population. So runners, who certainly probably have lower urine volumes overall, maybe, this wasn't studied, it was just looked at, had a higher incidence of kidney stones. There's lots of other things that went on there too. There's numerous studies that show similar observations that groups that seem to have maybe a predilection to lower urine volumes and more dehydration had higher incidence of kidney stones. But the reasons are probably complex. And they certainly suggested that moderate physical exercise without fluid supplementation at the same time or urinary alkalinization, making the pH of that urine higher, could lead to enhanced crystallization and formation of stones. But poor fluid intake, really as one factor, has not been studied extensively, at least for primary prevention of kidney stones. Now, as a secondary prevention mechanism, for people who have known history of forming kidney stones, their fluid intake and higher fluid intakes have clearly shown to be beneficial. So here, increased fluid intake is certainly a mainstay of secondary prevention and acts by making the urine more dilute. The stuff that forms the stones isn't present at as high a concentration. It doesn't crystallize out and form the stone. Now, in the first randomized controlled trial of increased fluid intake, those with a history of stones who were able to keep their urine output above 2 liters per day had about a 55% reduction in the incidence of stones. There was one primary prevention study back in 1966 in Israel that supported that higher fluid intakes also were beneficial, but it's really a smaller study done quite a long time ago now. So for nephrolithiasis, I think there's probably, in aggregate, high quality intake supporting the role of maintaining a higher urine output for the secondary prevention of kidney stones. For primary prevention, as I said, that data is less robust, but observational studies certainly probably support that. And the American College of Physicians, the American Society of Nephrology, for secondary prevention, we recommend maintaining your urine output at about 2 liters per day with a fluid intake slightly above that. And that's been highly supported in high-risk populations. So there's an example of a very selected group of patients where a slightly higher fluid intake seems to be beneficial in secondary prevention of a clear medical condition. I would observe, though, we're not talking 5 or 6 liters a day. We're talking more than 2 liters of urine output per day, so a relatively modest increase. What about urinary tract infections and fluid intake? So the theory goes, and it makes sense, that if you have an increased diuresis, that's going to have a diluting effect on any contaminating bacteria and any virulence factors that may reside in your bladder and your urethra. So flushing out the bladder with each void removes bacteria. If you flush it out more frequently, the odds of that bacteria creating an infection are going to go down. Finally, a higher urine osmolality, a more concentrated urine, and a lower, more acidic pH is associated with lower fluid intakes, and that may also indirectly injure the urinary epithelium, the bladder lining, and more predispose it to infection. So what about the data? So the association of UTIs with voiding frequency is very controversial, with studies showing that more voiding frequency is beneficial, less voiding frequency increases your risk. There's other studies that don't show that. Now, there are some genetic conditions and some childhood illnesses where frequent voiding is important, but in most adults, there's no data that says that more frequent voiding will cause you to decrease your risk of urinary tract infections. There's very low quality observational data on the role of fluid intake. The best study is probably in US teachers who, as they're teaching, don't have high fluid intakes, and they had a higher risk for UTIs. Now, that's low quality data. There's also some self-monitoring of a urine osmolality as a guide to increased drinking. So if that urine was very concentrated, that was gonna be basically a cue that you need to drink some more. And that was effective in one intervention study to decrease the risk for your recurrent UTIs. But overall, the data really isn't very robust that says more frequent drinking or voiding decreases your risk for a urinary tract infection. Now, moving on, this is probably the most controversial issue, and there's actually a lot of data emerging in this area. It's whether drinking more fluids, essentially, lowers your risk of kidney disease. So if I have chronic kidney disease, which typically progresses once it starts, if I drink more fluids, will that lower my risk of progression? The data initially arises in a group of patients with polycystic kidney disease, a genetic condition, where the idea was that these patients can have higher vasopressin levels, and the role of vasopressin modulates tubular cell growth, affects the renal microcirculation, it causes vasoconstriction, and alters renal blood flow. And by extension, the thinking is that sustained increases in vasopressin could lead to damage of the kidneys, and that chronic increases in water would lower that vasopressin and protect the kidney from the effects of vasopressin to cause that injury. And schematically, it looks like this. So a patient with chronic kidney disease, they typically retain salt, solutes, that may lead to a slightly hyperosmolar state, and vasopressin secretion. That vasopressin secretion through multiple mechanisms can perpetuate kidney injury. And the idea would be here that by drinking excess water, you would break the cycle, break that hyperosmolar state, and decrease the vasopressin levels. So what's the data on this? So if you look at patients with autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, in animal models of polycystic kidney disease, the ingestion of large amounts of water actually does suppress vasopressin and actually slows progression of the kidney disease. And that's where the experimental data begins to come from. However, when that has been translated into a clinical human trial of increasing water intake in humans with this condition, water intake was actually associated with more rapid progression of the chronic kidney disease, despite having lower vasopressin levels. Now, further studies are needed in this area, and a recent sort of epidemic in Central America of this new kidney disease that's called Mesoamerican Central American nephropathy, at least there, chronic dehydration in these workers that don't have access to water in very brutal conditions in the Central America, that chronic cycle of dehydration and high vasopressin levels has been linked as a potential risk factor. Now, most recently, Clark up in Canada has done looking at several studies of water intake and the risk for either mild or moderate or more severe declines in kidney function has actually shown that those patients who are able to increase their urine volumes to about 3 liters or more actually have lower risks for progression of kidney disease. And that's shown here graphically. As you can see, the risk goes lower with the higher urine outputs or the higher water intake. Now, in other data, observational studies again, a study in Australia demonstrated that high flu intake, about 3.2 liters per day, is associated with about a 50% reduction in the risk of CKD as opposed to the lower fluid intake. Clark showed an inverse graded relationship between urine volume and the decline in GFR, and significant benefit as you went to higher urine volumes. But Hebert actually found something different, that actually higher urine volumes were associated with faster progression. So there's still a lot of controversy in this area, and there's no clear evidence right now that links higher urine volumes, higher fluid intake, to the progression of kidney disease and benefit in slowing that progression. Now, luckily, we're going to have a randomized controlled trial of fluid intake. So Clark up in Canada is actually going to test whether increased fluid intake slows the progression of kidney disease. An important study in my world where a simple intervention may show benefit, but it's actually going to be studied in a very well-done randomized controlled clinical trial. Now, lastly, fluid intake in bladder cancer. Just the bottom line here is that the modern evidence is relatively weak. There are studies that show some benefit. There's other studies that have shown no benefit. So the randomized control trial is needed here. It's a relatively simple trial that I hope somebody will do. But the relative evidence on fluid intake protecting somebody from the risk of bladder cancer is relatively low. Now, in the last couple of minutes, I also want to just talk about some other myths embedded in the 8x8. The idea that thirst is somehow too late. What's the evidence for that belief? And I want to go back maybe to something that Dr. Verbalis said and went over with vasopressin. So a couple of facts. A rise in serum osmolality of less than 2% is enough to elicit thirst. Whereas you've heard from several speakers this morning, dehydration is defined as beginning when a person has lost 3% or more of their body weight. That essentially translates into a rise in serum osmolality of about 5%. The threshold for release of vasopressin, that osmolality of 285, is lower than that of thirst at 294. Thus, moment-to-moment needs for water balance are met by changes in vasopressin concentrations and changes in the urine flow, as you saw eloquently demonstrated. And it's really, I think, hard to imagine that evolutionary development somehow left us with a chronic water deficit that has to be compensated by artificially forcing fluid intake. It makes no sense. And here's graphically just showing you, this is the link between plasma osmolality in the bottom, plasma vasopressin levels, or thirst. And what you can see here, that's the line when dehydration begins. You can see that both vasopressin begins at much lower osmolalities, and the thirst sensation much lower as well. So both of those mechanisms exist to kick in to protect us well before we become dehydrated. So let me just conclude and say that I think there's scant evidence to support the idea that simply increasing fluid intake to an arbitrary and high amount somehow improves health. Now, there are certain conditions where that's true, but those are certain conditions that require medical treatment, secondary prevention of nephrolithiasis, perhaps those with chronic UTIs. The notion that somehow thirst sensation is not adequate and does not protect us against dehydration, I think is simply incorrect. And that myth, I think, has created lots of problems. And I think it's one of the myths that's out there in the lay public that forces the drinking behavior that we've seen. For some populations, I think we need some randomized controlled trials about what's the adequate volume of fluid that people need. But the risks of overhydrating are clearly well documented, and they need to be considered in the back end of these recommendations and the cultural norms that we are promoting. When you see those students walking around with gallon jugs of water, I think it's potentially scary. So thank you for your attention.